releasing the falsehoods.
So Curtis, if you don't know, I'm Gary Fries, and I am from here, Iowa City, and Richard's son, and I haven't lived here since 1977. And essentially, I've been asked to come talk to you about the overall history of Troutman. I am, of course, a plagiarist in doing this because much of the research was done by Jimmy Alley, who read all the newspapers in Statesville and who has provided much of what I will be using today. So what Curtis has asked me to do is talk about my take on Troutman. That in many ways is what I do, is I do a take on history. And so what I'm going to focus on is the period from the first settlement to the Great Depression. And I'm going to use as my symbolic ending when Mr. Troutman, one of the first Troutmans, dies in 1935, because he was one of the great chroniclers of the early part of the community. So I'll start with the beginning, and the beginning is that the original people who lived here don't stay to live in Troutman. And so that the first actual record we have of folks who lived in this area are mostly people who are English and who essentially are taking up land as speculators. So they include, for example, a man named David Black, who owned the land on the Buffalo Shoals Road from Kyle's Crossroads to the river. He will live here for about 30 years. There is also the Young family, and some Troutmanites are descendants of them. They lived in the area where we've recently rediscovered Sherrill's Path from the 1750s, and I think I've been able to locate the Young homestead not too far from where Tally Road or Tally Street goes towards the Mambo Road. There was also a Chambers family. There was also, and in fact, the first actual permanent settler is the Davidson family, and I'll let the sheriff sit down here. The Davidson family actually is very important to the understanding of Troutman, and if you don't know, they lived off what is the Wallace Springs Road and lived near where Third Creek is in the Wallace Springs area. Essentially, they're it before the American Revolution. Almost every family, I've left out the cabins, I'm sorry, the cabin family, lived to the southwest of what is Troutman today, and they're there by the 1750s as well. But outside of that, the folks that we associate with our town were not here before the American Revolution. The first one who actually comes, who is part of the, shall we say, the migration that creates the town, is Jacob Troutman, who begins to arrive here in the 1780s, and he is the first of a number of Germans who come here from Rowan County, beginning about the time the Revolution is over, and they migrate here for a generation. They're the Lipperts, the Holzhausers, the Troutmans. They include the Beringers of Beringer Township, most particularly to the east of here, the Hoovers, and they are the backbone of the neighborhood that becomes Troutman. And so you have them come in. You also have, after the Revolution, the beginnings of the congregation that becomes New Perth, and that includes people named White, people named Falls, and particularly the elements of the Brown family come over here, and they too are part of Troutman. They aren't in the town, for there is no town, because this was very much a rural settlement well into the 1800s, and people simply live scattered out across here. And my basic model that I use when I teach North Carolina history is that most communities in the early 1800s were about 8 miles square. Everybody hear that? About 8 miles square. Does anybody know why 8 miles? If you live in one corner, you can walk from one corner to the next at 3 miles an hour and still get home before dark. And that, if you think about what I've just told you, I've explained to you the difference between Berriam Springs and the distance to Amity Hill, the distance to Woodleaf, and the distance to Landis or China Grove. And I can go in the opposite direction if you would like. In other words, all these places that have names, Mount Mourne, how far away is it? Not too much further than 8 to 10 miles. So all of these places have names, Shepherds, Mount Mourne, etc., that are about 8 miles across. And inside that area is where you found the basic services that everyone needed. So you would have had one or more blacksmith shops. You would have had one or more millers. You would have had one or more distillers. Those were the Troutmans. You would have the Youngs as well. The Youngs got rich because they were distillers. And remember that everyone else was dependent upon the distillers because they were the ready manufacturers of their grain and their fruit. And so that one of the key products in this area was actually alcohol from the beginning. Cotton does not arrive here in any kind of quantity until 1870. There's hardly any cotton grown before the Civil War. So everyone had a task, and everyone had a function, and everyone had, in a sense, a role in the community. So you had Kessler's Mill, which was located up on the Amity Hill Road near Statesville. You had Troutman's Mill, which was originally Cavan's Mill, down where Lake Norman State Park is. And you had Arthur's Mill, which was in the edge of the community towards Amity Hill. You will notice none of those mills is in Troutman, or in the center of anything. In fact, Troutman wasn't the center of this community. This community had no center. Now, the closest thing that there was to it was the very scattered cluster of churches that eventually will become New Perth, St. Michael's, and a series of other churches, including the Cambridge one, which were to the south of where Troutman is today. And they began to be built in the early 1800s, and they are a reflection, meaning they're a focus of the actual settlement pattern that I've been talking about. There are no churches here before there are enough people here to have the churches. So St. Michael's, which is established in 1815 and celebrating its anniversary this year, was actually established as an outpost of both the Episcopal Church and the Lutheran Church by members of the Harkey family, the Lippert family, the Bussell family. The Bussells lived over on the other side of where Lake Norman State Park is, and the Mills family, who lived to the south of where St. Michael's Cemetery is today. These people worship there from a distance of, guess what?
8 miles.
8 miles. In other words, I've gone and measured who these people were. And there were only about 20 of them, at most a dozen families. So what I'm trying to get across to you is that it's a very slow process that creates this community. By the 18-teens and 20s, you have the Ostwalts, you have the Clodfelters, you have the Holzhausers, and other families which you're familiar with coming into here, again from Cabarrus County and from Rowan County. And by 1820 to 1830, this is, by and large, the majority of people are German in their descent. So one of the characteristics of Troutman is that it is one of North Carolina's German heritage communities. Now, that doesn't mean everyone was German. The people who went to New Perth were, by and large, descendants of Scottish immigrants of some type or another. But fundamentally, what you had was a largely German enclave in the midst of a county that was by and large Scots-Irish. So once you crossed Third Creek and Fourth Creek, you went into the Scots-Irish section of Iredell County, and once you went past Withrow's Creek, that's Shepherd's Crossroads, you ended up in the second Scots-Irish community, and we were a wedge of Germans in between. And those Germans then skipped over another Scots-Irish community, which was what we call today New Stirling, or where West Iredell High School is. And then their sons often settled in Alexander County, up around where you might know of as Friendship Lutheran Church. And so what becomes Troutman was a German enclave scattered across this 8x8 square, so to speak, none of whom were wealthy in terms of slaves or cash. Now, some owned thousands of acres. The Hoovers, Jacob Troutman and his sons, were highly wealthy with land, but none had the kind of wealth of the first settlers, the Youngs or the Davidsons, because they had been here first, they had established more of a base, and they, in a sense, were the leading citizens, yet they did not make up the majority. And that was the basic state of this community for about 50 years. One of the most remarkable things I've found recently is a map from the early 1850s, about the time when the Troutmans, that we'll talk about in just a minute, built their wagon shops and their blacksmith shop. I have found a map of the original plan for the state railroad, and it did not go where it goes today. Now, if you don't know, the Western Railroad, as it was called originally, is the one that goes from Salisbury to Statesville to Hickory, and you may cross it if you go up the Old Mountain Road. The original idea was for that railroad to not leave Salisbury, but to leave the main line at China Grove, go to where Shepherd's is today, come up what is Highway 115 today through Troutman, and follow the Old Mountain Road all the way to Taylorsville. And there actually is a map in Raleigh that shows that route, that shows where Troutman is today, and it does have what is called a smith shop marked somewhere in the vicinity of what is Troutman. It shows the intersection, I think I just got attacked by Troutman. It shows the vicinity, it shows the intersection of the Old Mountain Road and what is today the Mambo Road and what was then called the Charlotte Road. And it's a very convoluted area with lots of intersections that was surprisingly more complex than I thought it would be. And so what I saw was actually the first attempt to set up Troutman. I think that the Troutmans must have known that the actual railroad might have come through here, and they essentially then set up the smith shop in anticipation of that. It didn't happen. As you know, it went through Statesville. And then around 1860, Interest, who had great ambition, tried to set up a railroad that would go from Charleston, South Carolina to Cincinnati, Ohio. They called it the Atlantic, Tennessee, and Ohio Railroad. It eventually went from Charlotte to Statesville. It is the railroad that many of you remember coming here through Troutman. It was also known as the slowest railroad in North Carolina. There are stories of passengers being left at sidings, yelling at the engineer, and the engineer doesn't hear it over the noise, and within a half a mile, of course, the person has jumped onto the train. In fact, the AT&O once put up a sign in its passenger cars, "Would passengers please not get out and walk beside the train as it moves?" So my suspicion is it never came barreling through here in Troutman in that period. The railroad was actually built right before the Civil War. The Troutmans, A.D. Troutman, and I always get my initials mixed up, but J.D. Troutman, had come here, built a wagon shop, built a blacksmith shop. They had also built the first house that is Troutman's, which is Family Dollar today, where the Family Dollar is, Dollar General is today. Sorry, they're all merging. And essentially, they had begun to set up shop at a crossroads. This was where essentially Perth Road went down to Sherrill's Ford. That was the point of the road. And where the main road continued down to Mount Morn. There was no Mooresville at that time. They had a construction camp near the site of the wagon shop, and the railroad was all but completed to Statesville when the war came. During the war, that railroad was torn up and taken away because the equipment and the rails were needed elsewhere for the Confederate war effort. And the railroad was not restored until about 1871. And a depot, Troutman's, hence the apostrophe S, was put here at Troutman. The original depot, we think, does go back to 1861. If you do not know, it is still preserved by the Troutman family at the Troutman Family Cemetery to the west of here. And it is the oldest railroad building in the state of North Carolina. That has been preserved. And so Troutman became a depot stop, and that became what created the community. Troutman was what we call in the trade of the post-Civil War history a convergence community. In other words, the depot caused everyone to bring their services within range of the depot itself. Because the entire economy changes after the Civil War. Instead of it being a local economy based upon local trade and barter, where you sold surpluses elsewhere, After the Civil War, the dynamics of the economy changed, and everyone was essentially forced to market as fast as they could to make the money that they could. North Carolina, for example, changed the laws of how you kept livestock. Before the Civil War, you had to fence in your crop. Most people don't remember that. If you built a fence, the fence was there to protect your crop from wildlife and livestock. The livestock had the run of the woods. And in fact, the woods looked much different. If you had been here in 1850, those woods, you could have seen through them because the livestock would have eaten all the underbrush. They would have eaten the honeysuckle. You can see that in cow pastures today. Have you ever seen it where the trees, nothing is there for 6 feet, and then suddenly the trees are there? Almost all the woods looked like that back then. Our landscape does not look like it did then. This is not what our ancestors saw in many ways. They changed that law, and suddenly you had to fence in your livestock because there was more of an emphasis upon growing crops, marketing them, and making your money that way. Troutman's Depot became basically the convergence of these resources. And Troutman's first product was wood. As Jimmy Alley and his research has shown, the very first businesses here were sawmills, a handle factory that made spokes and handles that were marketed in England. Troutman actually was on an international map for that very early. And it was a convergence of people who had begun to grow that new crop, cotton. And so what you had was the beginnings of the great change that creates Troutman, industrialization. But Troutman was a processor for 40 years. So during the 1880s and into the 1890s, there are no factories. There are still shops. The grist mills are still located in the same corners. The Troutmans have the first roller mill, which is the great new technology of the 1880s. It's located where it was located where the state park is. And all of this is beginning to change the landscape. What they do essentially is they cut all the trees down. And the paper essentially says very clearly by 1889, they have basically clear cut this area.
What's a roller mill?
A roller mill, the old-fashioned grist mill, was when you grind with stones and you keep whole wheat flour. One of the worst inventions of mankind was a roller mill because it created Wonder Bread. The rollers were so fast that they burnt the wheat. Where the grist actually crushes it, the rollers burn it, which is why you take the brand off. The brand is where the scorch taste was left. So you sifted it finely and you ended up with white flour, which by the 20th century becomes the norm. And it's just as alien to our ancestors as these woods were. But you see, when they cut the trees down, when the trees come back, this is the woods we get. So all of you who remember this from, you know, whenever you grew up, this is the great change that comes in the 1880s. With it comes cotton. And the increasing emphasis upon growing cotton to make the money that people need to have. Well, to have cotton, you must market it. To market it, you must have a depot. And to feed yourself, you must go to a store. And so the Youngs, who first got rich making alcohol, will move to town and open the drug stores and the grocery stores. They'll be joined by Mr. Wagner. They'll be joined by Mr. Patterson. They'll be joined by a host of people named Brown. It will start out as storekeepers and then open a bank and then open the factories of the 20th century. The pattern of Troutman is the pattern that's Americans' pattern at the time. This is no different from China Grove. This is no different from Landis. It's not very much different from the little town of Catawba across the river, with one key exception. Troutman does not establish a mill village. So when you go to a China Grove and you go to a Landis, it existed very early as a mill village for cotton mills. That was always a sideshow for Troutman. It was never the reason the town existed. And so from the beginning, it has been a convergence center, a marketing center, and with it came all the things that go with being a community. The Lutherans moved their church here in the 1880s. The Methodists will build a church in the 1880s. The Presbyterians will soon follow. The ARPs will build their newer church at Perth and stay in the country until the early 20th century. All those things are happening in the 1880s. And then comes, in the 1890s, the Great Depression of that period. It was called the Panic of 1893. The newspapers are not real good to tell us exactly what happened to Troutman during this period. Statesville goes through serious bankruptcies, and therefore if Statesville suffering, obviously Troutman will too. But what we see is that Troutman has a revival about 1903, 1904, 1905. And I am convinced it is connected to the real advent of cotton. That cotton takes over here about the turn of the century. It takes until then to do it really well. And you just suddenly see the town blossom. So within 10 years, you go from having a small academy to a public high school, the biggest one in the county. You go from having no bank to having a bank. You get electricity. The road gets paved from Charlotte to Statesville. And suddenly all the businesses and all the people that many of you grew up knowing as our elder citizens start appearing in the papers. So you suddenly see stories with Ken Suther and Tate Lofton and Mr. Leon Brown and all his other Brown partners and all the people that we are used to. Even Earl Lippert Sr. will show up with a filling station, etc., in the papers by the early 1920s. The Troutman we know was really flowering about the time of the First World War. And so all these services and these houses are all, in a sense, products of this process that takes about 50 years to hit its peak. And then my suspicion is, and that's about where I stopped my reading of Mr. Alley's work, is that all of us then enjoyed that wave. That the Troutman of 1940, the Troutman of 1950, the Troutman of 1960 even, was the product, if you will, of that great change in the early part of the 20th century. Because we still only had one bank, we still only had one drugstore, we still only had a couple of grocery stores. The shirt mill starts by 1920, it's still there. Mr. Kale's cotton mill does not last that long. The Baptist Church is a product of the mill village. It comes along with the mill village. That's why there is a Church of God at the south end of town, because mill folks went to the Church of God in the 1920s. In other words, the pattern I see elsewhere is the pattern that Troutman has, with one key exception. Troutman never changes rapidly. And at least so far in its history, it never loses its roots. It has built upon itself every time and every step of the way in each period of its history. And one of the things Mr. Alley found that I think is the best quote I've ever seen about us is that Troutman, according to one of its early residents, was built upon hard work and conservatism. And I suspect that may be the watchword of what much of the 20th century was as well. So, in a way, what I found when I stopped the reading was, and I need to put the mic down so I can read this. In 1932, the height of the Great Depression, the postmaster in Troutman, whose name was T.A. Kennedy, was almost dismissed because he had not contributed enough to the last election, the 1930 political election, to the Republicans, because he had been the postmaster during the Republican era of the 1920s when Republicans were presidents, and he was summarily dismissed, and everyone had an opportunity to become the postmaster by taking the exam. The man who made the highest grade was a young man named Ken Suther, but the paper said he was a Democrat, so they wrote him off immediately. The second highest was Mr. Kennedy, who took the exam. The third highest was Tate Lofton, and he too was a Democrat, according to the paper, and, quote, he was shelved. And they hired Mr. Kennedy back because they couldn't hire any of the Democrats. Obviously, Republicans couldn't read and write back then, but that was another story. And Guy Matheson, whom some of you may remember, was hired as the clerk. I'm assuming that Guy, with my memory, could read and write. So What I found there was a transition, because as most of you know, in 1933, the New Deal will arrive, the landscape will change, the ways in which Troutman vote will change, but the patterns of schools, of churches, of our stores, Vance Wagner appears in these papers in World War I, and all these things are there, and there was a stability to Troutman until all the great changes we lived through began to happen in the 1970s. But that's some of you and me, and that in history yet. I will tell you one last thing and then open up to anything I may not know. And that is, I am working on an article for a study of North Carolina in the First World War. And my job is to look for pro-German sentiment in the state. And I went looking everywhere there was a Lutheran church. And I need to let you know that I've only found it in two places. One was south of Hickory, and one was here. Troutman was implicitly, everybody understand what I mean? Implicitly pro-German in the war. Now, how do I know that? Well, it's very hard to measure, but I found a way. Do any of you remember your parents or grandparents may have bought war bonds during the war? First World War to finance it, and if you were a kid, you bought war stamps at school, and they did that. Well, the Record and Landmark put every Iredell citizen in the paper who bought any World War bonds. And they did it by township. Everybody got it? So I read the list. Union Grove is this long. New Hope is this long. Cool Springs is longer than my arm. And Troutman's this big.
Wow.
Fascinating. Well, that's not the proof. The proof is, back then, we were noted for our local correspondence. So Mr. W.D. Troutman was our correspondent. Now, he's not writing during World War I. But a woman named Isabella Troutman, who was married to Mr. L. Troutman, some of you may remember, Dot Ingram's father, help me here. Who else have I got here? Vicky Troutman's grandfather.
She was a Stevenson.
Yes, she was a Stevenson. She wrote columns about the glory of Germany and how sad people were around Troutman because they would have to go fight. Not that they were opposed to the war. They did not disrupt draft notices. Troutman made a big deal of setting up a Red Cross. They had big meetings at the school, and it was obvious that they were a little tainted. And when Armistice Day came, most papers are glorifying the fact that they have wiped out tyranny, and Mrs. Troutman writes, an ode to the lost glory of Germany. World War I. And this area, now there is an area south of Hickory that I'm also studying, but I didn't find this kind of thing in Salisbury. I did not find this kind of thing in Cabarrus County. I cannot tell you why, except that my theory is that Troutman in this area has remained grounded to its past. It's slow to change, but seldom does the trees get uprooted. And I suspect it's still true, at least somewhere around here, despite the fact your roads are horrendous. Who knew that Perth Road could become a racetrack?
Yeah.
I'll let anybody ask me anything and probably tell you I don't know.
I just wanted to say something might help everyone. In this issue of Our State, the magazine, there's a whole article on the trains in North Carolina. So I didn't get to read it because I've been reading other things. But. Mm-hmm.
Two, why was the section of track that went through Troutman, why was it the slowest in the state, and why was it pulled up years later?
You mean why was it pulled up in our lifetime?
Yes.
Because we were stupid and we let it happen.
Yeah.
It was one of the stupidest things. There have been two great stupid things happen in Iredell County in my lifetime. The first one was Turnersburg Road and that bottleneck where they let all those stores be built. You know, we should have let the Russians nuke that. You may quote me. Kosti Kute has heard this before. And the other one was, what fool let that railroad be pulled up that we could now be a commuter town to Charlotte? It is the great tragedy of us.
Because the trestle is still in place down there.
Oh, yeah.
And my wife...
Oh, no, we could be a community... You know, you could work in Charlotte now if we had rapid transit. And the problem's going to be that you can never relay it because of the right-of-ways have been lost and all that. You know, oh, that was... I knew when they were tearing it up. I remember talking... Let's see, Leroy Sims. Chatty's husband was Leroy. He loved it, you know, because he wasn't going to have to mow on it and everything. And I said, no, someday we're going to need that. Someday we're going to need those trains. Because, you know, we used to think the interstate was a good thing to drive on.
Oh, yeah.
Boy, were we wrong about that one, too. That help? Why was it... Oh, they had no money. It was a cheap John Railroad. I mean, the original AT&O was... It was a great idea that never went anywhere.
Huh. Because my wife was telling... She used to drive a school bus back in the 70s, and she said the trains went slow through here, and she could actually outrun the train in the school bus.
Sure.
I don't know if it was making all the stops along the way is why it was so slow, or was
I'm sure back then the rails were in terrible shape because Southern did not maintain them. I'm sure that's the case. You know, it is only by the miracle of Pomp Compton, that's the name, which Mr. Compton, that, you know, he bought the depot and made it into a hay barn, and it sat there until the Troutmans rescued it. 73, 74, wasn't it?
76
we did that, yeah. Yeah. Anybody else? Way in the back.
Do you by chance know when the Simpsons came to this area?
No, I'm sorry, I don't. There are Simpson families across the river that I've run across to in the 18th century, but I can't tell you when they came over here.
Okay. Well, these Simpsons would have lived off of Houston Road.
Doesn't help me. I'm sorry. Afraid I don't know. Well, if we're about to take out a piece of paper, I am a college professor.
Pop quiz.
Oh, this is not pop quiz. This is a final exam. Well, I want to thank everybody. If you want to talk about anything, I can hang around. I wish you well. Realize that Troutman's problems are everyone's problems in the sense of sprawl, in the sense of congestion. We face a very interesting century. You know, the thing I will leave you with, however, is that this idea we had when I grew up of a little compact village doesn't exist anywhere anymore. You know, there is no contiguous community anywhere. Annexation has become a very strange sort of corporate takeover game. And the redefinition of community is really the question that everybody's facing. And the fact that our infrastructure is crumbling everywhere isn't new here. I mean, these are things we all face as Americans. And Troutman's as American as anything else in what it faces, I think. So,
thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Did you want to highlight anything on the map? Or
I'd be glad to look at it. This is the map from the World War I era. If you've never seen it, you can actually buy this in black and white at the Which county map office? The map, the GIS office, isn't it? But this shows you which folks lived where. So here's the county home. Notice that Barium is actually separated. You can actually see where Mambo Road comes in here. It shows the Brookshire Farm, which is Brookshire Boulevard, because Stan Brookshire became the mayor of Charlotte and was from here. Ostwalt School was up that was a house for many years, essentially. You ought to come up and see it. It's fascinating in the different ways in which you can see how things work. You see exactly the way Perth Church looked then as the way it looks now in terms of the site and the plan. There was, of course, no Lake Norman. Anyway.
50 what? Lake Norman, 50?
They start at 57. They start filling it in 61.
It was full pond in 63.
Yep. 63 was full.
Actually, if anybody wants a copy of this, go right down the street, see Aaron at the sign shop. He has it under Harriet's name and under my name, Curtis Fortner. He's got it saved, and he'll print you one out. I think it's, what, 18?
It wasn't
the full map?
Yes, he'll do it just like this. You'll get an exact copy of this laminated, the whole nine yards. And he turns it around in a day, usually.
The reason that Troutman's in the corner is that the Troutmans are all living here. You will notice how the positioning worked here.
Oh, okay.
And the Lippards, of course, live in the second place. But.
And we got this for the Lippard reunion last fall to include the Troutmans on the map. there as well.
You
so,
could. It's a
well,
fascinating
what we did
map.
Where
it
the
really is.
And
he's
and
got
ahead.
It on the computer. He'll print it out for you and very minimal cost, but it's a wonderful thing to have.
You can also go down to the tax office and get a full map
that's
of Iredell County.
You get the whole
that's,
county. You can also see that at our branch library.
Yeah,
it's
dated 1916.
These were not that unusual. There's one for Catawba, there's one for Rowan. There's one for Davidson, I think.
When did Troutman get electricity here?
I read that there. Today, and I...
After the Second World War.
They had lights.
But on up on
1919, they will have lights connecting to the power plant at Barium, according to these Mr.
Power Allen's. Plant at Barium?
Barium would have had its own generator.
Because I had always been interested in the East Mumbo village down there, and they had that.
They built a generator, and when they built the concrete dam, they also put an electrical generator. I think it was 1906 or something.
At Mumbo?
Yes.
Yeah.
What is the date of this map? S is still on the Troutmans, and that was gone in 57.
That should be 1917.
Yeah, this is a World War I map.
Yeah,
okay.
1917.
Because I don't have it laminated.
That
now,
was gone
then.
The S disappeared, I think, mm-hmm. around 57.
57
no,
what?
This
1957?
Mm-hmm.
That long?
Yeah.
I mean, that recently?
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh. Uncle Richard never stopped saying Troutman.
Well, I know
yeah,
Hoy,
a lot of people still
Uncle
say Troutman.
Always said Troutman, so yeah. I don't remember your daddy saying
Troutman. I'm not so sure your dad didn't always say Troutman. Did he? Did? Somebody I remember.
Uncle Hoy. That's the only thing.
I've noticed around here you can tell who the locals were because they refer to Lake Norman as the river. Go down to the river.
Now they nostalgically want the river.
They would like for it to be the river.
Well, there really was a river there once.
Yeah.
Gary.
Yes, Doc.
I'm originally from Cabarrus County, so I'd like to know a little bit more about the history of Cabarrus County.
Okay, but I can't do that this talk. We talk right after.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, I'm
sure.
not going to say much
I
about
was raised in Concord, by the way.
Another Cabarrus County. But he hit the nail on the head when he explained. We started out small, we're still small, we're probably going to always remain that way, but there's going to be growth, there's going to be expansion. It's just a matter of how it's handled and what you do. I guess the bottom line to the way Gary feels and the way I feel, and I come off of three limbs of the Troutman family tree, so don't ask me to explain because it just gets crazy. But I am very much Troutman, very, very proud of that too. And as a whole community, there are a lot of folks my age coming back like I've done, but what's neat about Troutman is there's a history here that a lot of people don't know about, and these are not a few brag lines, but I'll just throw them out. You see, there are a lot of things. For example, the Lone Star flag in the state of Texas, how many people are familiar with that? Designed and sewn by Joanna Troutman, who is a descendant of the very Troutmans that founded this town. The first cornea transplant in the entire world, where a woman opened her eyes and could see her daughter's image, was performed by Dr. Richard Troutman in New York City. And up until 1979, he attended our family reunions, flew down from New York City and was there for a few days. He and his father both pioneered the cornea transplant mechanisms and designed the tiny little equipment and everything that was used throughout the world. They're both dead and gone now, but what a legacy to have. You know, Doris Troutman Plin, The Green Song, The Violet Tree, two children's novels that have sold over 1 million copies. And, you know, all these people have connections. Doris was born and raised here, right over on East Mumbo Road. There's a lot of history, that sprang from the roots in this town. And you know, the town right now is looking for a slogan that best describes Troutman. And when is the meeting in June, Paul?
It'll be the second Thursday of the month.
Second Thursday of the month in June. I think they're going to discuss it again. But all of you, you know, if you live here, take a few minutes, sit down with a piece of paper, and you know, think about some of the things Gary has shared with us, and just take a look around. This is a forever thing,
in my opinion, when you do something like that. And it needs to express a little something from the past, a little something from the present, and something from the future. And there's a lot of great minds under this tent, and a lot of great minds in this town. So I would ask you to take a few minutes and get those to the folks at Town Hall, and I hope we have a giant stack to look through, because it's important. It's an identity on top of a historic area. So anyway, but Gary, thank you so much.
Thank
it's
you
always. You know so much.
Remember that.